beginning their day with prayer here at Holy Mass. We will celebrate the traditional rite of our Holy Mass as we celebrate with a Gloria and without a Creed this day. So as we give great thanksgiving to God for our presence here this day, may we pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I will go to the altar of God. Our help is in the name of the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, let us now kneel and confess our sins before Almighty God as we prepare for today's Holy Mass. Having confessed your sins before our Lord and using our first confidier, I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, my own grace, and I am truly sorry that I have offended you. Most loving Father, have mercy on me, and forgive my sins. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify it, that I may become worthy to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask the Blessed Mother Mary, all the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. As an act of penance this day, I ask that for whatever meal that you sit and whatever meal you offer God thanks and praise and honor this day, I ask that you include Scripture to be a part of it. Whether it is taking out the old trusty family Bible and finding something or simply Googling Scripture with thanksgiving in it, I ask that you offer at least a verse within your prayer before you eat today, whatever meal that might be. Again, a verse of Scripture included in your prayer that you have looked up yourself. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. O God, you will again renew us.
And your people will rejoice in you.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come to you.
O Lord, be with you. Christ have mercy. Lord have mercy. accomplice, and your goodness infinite. On this day of thanksgiving, we come before you with gratitude for your abundant gifts. Open our hearts to the needs of others, so that we may share them in loving service. We pass this to our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Reading from the book of Sirach. And now, bless the God of all, who has done wondrous things on earth, who fosters people's growth from their mother's womb, and fashions them according to his will. May he grant you joy of heart, and may peace abide among you. May his goodness toward us endure in Israel, to deliver us in our days. This is the word of praise your name forever, Lord.
I will praise your name forever, Lord.
Every day I will bless you, and I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and highly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable.
I will praise your name forever, Lord.
Generation after generation praises your works and proclaims your might. They speak of the splendor of your glorious majesty and tell of your wondrous works.
I will praise your name forever, Lord.
They discourse of the power of your terrible deeds and declare your greatness. They publish the fame of your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your justice. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness. The Lord is good to all, and compassionate toward all his works.
I will praise your name forever, Lord.
Let all your works give you thanks, O Lord, and let your faithful ones bless you.
I will praise your name forever, Lord.
Our second reading is from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always on your account, for the grace of God bestowed on you in Him you are enriched in every way with all discourse and knowledge, as a testimony to Christ was confirmed among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift, as you wait for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will keep you firm to the end, irreproachable on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, and by him you were called to fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Cleanse me so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may truly proclaim this holy gospel. Alleluia, alleluia. I will thank you in the great assembly. I will praise you before the mighty throng. Traveled through Samaria and Galilee. As he was entering the village, 10 and lepers met him. They stood at a distance from him and raised their voice, saying, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." As they were going, they were cleansed. And one of them, realizing that he had been healed, returned, glorifying God in a loud voice. And he fell at the feet of Jesus and thanked him. He was a Samaritan. Jesus said in reply, 10 were cleansed, were they not? Where are the other 9? Has none but this foreigner returned to give thanks to God?" And he said to him, "Stand up and go. Your faith has saved you." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. O
thanks to my God always on your account. We're taking today's second reading, Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. This is a funny way to give thanks. 2020. We've been racking our brains about what we do have to be thankful for. Now, for me, it's kind of awkward already because we already did the Thanksgiving meal, the Friendsgiving meal this past Saturday. For safety's sake, my son, which everybody hears in the background, was coming off a 14-day quarantine, which means the one visitor who was immunocompromised that we were allowed to have was able to come over, actually. And we had a nice Thanksgiving. And he works at a place where there's cameras that have heat maps that make sure he doesn't get within 6 feet of each other, which means that was as safe as we possibly were at any point in 2020. As many gather around tables full of incredible food in just a number of hours, I think many prayers and offerings and conversations are going to go kind of, sort of, something like that. Well, in this year, what do we have to give thanks for? But each day, we're putting further and further into the rear view what a terrible year that this is going to go down in history in our country as. But now with multiple vaccinations looming, unfortunately, coinciding with our highest numbers day to day of people contracting the virus, the end seems so close, but so far, as the phrase goes. I think we'll have a wife who works at a hospital who gives insight for many things that aren't filtered by the media, I suppose we could say. But some of them are scary, how full the beds are getting at the hospital and how there's stuff being rearranged in order to configure everything that's going on in this world right now. But also that there's somewhat of a cheerfulness, because there is an end, and that there is vaccinations coming, that there is something sent to this world that's going to eradicate this world as well, what's in this world right now. I preface all of that right here because, as a pastor, I'm thankful for where we are right now as a parish, considering all that jigach that I just mentioned. Through creativity, and a commitment to providing a safe worship environment, as well as safe fundraising opportunities, we've held on to some positive momentum throughout this year. Now, there were some dark times, and I'm reminiscing a little bit. There were some dark times in those first few months where I'd have Mass and just stare at a cell phone that was silently staring back at me. Now, although attendance is down considerably at Holy Mass, I'm in awe of our online viewership each and every week, and I don't even know what that means. happening on our Lord's altar each and every week than we have in any of my 7 years serving this parish. We hit the 7-year mark just a couple of weeks ago. The story of Scripture is the story of God's relationship with his people. Of course, there are rich examples of people showing gratitude to God for whatever. We saw in today's gospel Jesus's frustration, Jesus's bemusement, that it was only a foreigner, that it was only a Samaritan that came back and gave thanks for being cleansed of, 2020 appropriate, a very contagious disease. At this point in the Gospel of Luke, chronologically as we read it, we have already heard Jesus speaking to how the kingdom would be open to those who perhaps weren't the first amongst God's chosen. We hear Jesus speak about how being rich was a detriment to get into heaven, that the more you had here, it was harder to get there. How there were sinners, like the prodigal son, who still had a chance to approach God in the heavenly confines, with God receiving him with an open heart. Jesus even mentioned how division would come upon families because of his holy name. In all of that, Jesus would go and preach, and we saw him get kicked out of towns, run out of his hometown, and have success in others. In his parables, he often propped up the spies to make sure that the people knew that God's glory was attainable to all, and that God sees things very differently than we do. And here in this 17th chapter of St. Luke's Gospel, all that preaching has come to life. Only the Samaritan in real life, not just the parable anymore, comes back to give thanks to Jesus for what had happened. Very reflective of that parable from the 10th chapter of St. Luke's Gospel, which we know so well. You know, one of the tools that we have at our disposal now that Jesus did then too is our use of the Psalms. It's comforting that we can read and experience those pieces of Scripture in the same way that Jesus preached and the apostles knew. The Psalms are, if anything, emotional. Some are anonymous, but some serve and come to life as an accompaniment to what King David did in his kingship, his ministry, his lordship, whatever we want to call it, with a good Bible giving you notes that this psalm right here pertains to this event in the life of David. It makes them seem alive in such a different way. For example, Psalm 38 is a prayer for those who are sick and in need of healing. Psalm 25 is for guidance for anybody that needs direction in life. Psalm 130 is the De Profundis, a penitential psalm that we still chant at funerals today. Psalm 135 calls for praise above all things. For Thanksgiving, we can turn to a number of them. Psalm 28, 65, 75, 92, 100, 138, and even more, depending on what we are thankful for. A little bit of a theme. People had a lot to be thankful for to direct that thanks towards God. Though not part of this parish's liturgy, each psalm has a particular chant and melody that has gone along with it for thousands of years. They generally match the tone of what the psalm says as well. If it's a happy psalm that speaks of happy things, you're humming it for the rest of the day and you're tiptoeing on clouds the whole way home. The more lamentable ones, and there's a one that happens on Palm Sunday that gets stuck in your head and you leave almost miserable going, oh my gosh. But like any good sad song, well, that just sticks in your heart as well, that we know. Which is that snippet of insight and history into our liturgical use of psalms, we turn back to the scripture of St. Paul. He lived his apostolic life, as we hear, with constant gratitude, and why not? He was literally heading this way in life, away from God, and a divine inspiration came, a divine action came, heading the completely opposite way. He went from persecuting God to embracing and preaching God. He offers thanks in almost every single one of his letters for how God has affected his life to all the various churches that he wrote to. A life lived in total offering to God, too. And though we can see how this little section of what we have in his letter to the first letter to the Corinthians concludes, I want to add what he wrote to the Thessalonians as well in his first letter to them. Chapter 5, verse 18. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. In all circumstances. St. Paul, in another passage of Scripture, tells us to pray constantly. And now it's give thanks in all circumstances. To pray constantly and be thankful always. It's a good reminder for what we need to just have a better disposition and attitude on our life. And maybe you're not quite there yet. Maybe we can't be thankful and happy and joyful in all circumstances, whatever St. Paul wants us to do. But we can start today. It's almost winter. The days are short. And by state edict, we're not allowed to stay out past 10 p.m. I don't know about you, I don't stay much awake past that anyway anymore, as a little kid. But if we give thanks to God for what we have today, in this faithful year, in this historic year, imagine how much easier it's going to be in a few weeks, in a few months, and even a year from now to be able to give thanks to God for all the gifts that he has provided. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. sacrifice of Jesus, draw us closer to our brothers and sisters. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Thank you.
for the whole human family, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands. And having lifted his eyes from heaven to you, his Almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. For this is my body, which is given for you." These souls, Lord, and all who rest in Christ, grant, we pray, a place of refreshment, light, and peace, through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, and all your saints who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts were always open to justice and mercy, and their lives patterned after their divine master, meriting eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, to Christ our Lord, by whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things.
Through him, with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence,
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from all evils, past, present, and future. And by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together with your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, and also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our day. Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God,
forever and ever.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also.
Christ, help us to receive it to everlasting life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I give you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns God forever and ever. Amen. Partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment or condemnation. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May that last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this, who lives and reigns with God the Father in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. I will take the bread of heaven and call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces he has given me? I will take the chalice of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. High praise I will call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Truly present. I love you above all things, and I long for you in my soul. Since I cannot receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart and heal my soul. I embrace you and unite myself with you. May I never be separated from you. Inflame my heart with the fire of your love, my Lord and Savior. just will give thanks.